Hey there, I'm Marc Fennell, and tonight on Insight, what does it take to be a good dad?
I just said, look, I'm a big, ugly, bearded guy. I know it says it's a mother's group. Can I join? And they were like, absolutely.
My parenting style depends very much on what my wife says.
Correct answer. Very good.
I always had a need to right the wrong. It's always been a gut need since I was like 12.
I wasn't there and it made me feel pretty crap about myself. A father should be there for these moments.
Literally, on your second date, you were changing nappies, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
He just opened his eye the smallest amount and I knew that he knew that I was there.
You pack the pads in and I'll carry this and you can carry the skateboard. You ready? Let's go. I think skateboarding is important for me because it's a release and, you know, my wife is very supportive to ensure that I get that time to go for a skate for myself. But for Max and I, it's also a bonding session. We get to skate and, you know, he can sit back and watch me have a skate and I can take his hands and help him skate as well. It's just that time together.
Morning, mate.
Morning, mate.
How are you?
Max is 4 and Mum went back to work at 3 months.
We're going to go to the skate park today.
It's a great privilege to be able to have that opportunity to stay home with him. I want to make every day an adventure for him. All right. Let's go. I think those first few weeks where Mum went to work and Max and I were together, that was very challenging for me because I just, you know, you're just not sure whether you're doing the right thing. There's no manual that comes with kids and you're literally just, you're winging it every day, every hour of every day.
And then you go backwards. Well done.
Go, Dad, help me go!
I never had a dad growing up. My dad left when I was probably 3, 3 and a half, so I have very, very minimal memories of him.
Shall we slide together? Let's have a slide together.
I didn't have a father figure, so I had no idea whether I was doing this right. I think in reality, it's the same for every dad, but more so for me that I'm writing this script myself. You know, I don't have anything to look upon to reference or anything like that. So, you know, I'm just writing this script as I go.
Thank you all for being here. Cameron, you're both dad goals and beard goals, as far as I can tell.
Thank you.
Me back to the beginning. Your primary carer for your 4-year-old son, Max, yep. How did that start?
Well, it was purely a financial decision to start with, I think. I think when you look at having children, you think who can support who, how can you do it? Do we need to put them in 5 days a week at daycare? Can we have someone stay at home? And we did the sums and the opportunity was for us to be able to have someone stay at home. And that was something I put my hand up for and the wife was great.
You mentioned in there that your father wasn't around very much when you were a kid. How do you take on that role of being a dad when you don't have that role model to fall back on?
I think you've just got to trust your instincts in some ways and just look at other fathers and see how they're doing it. And you've just, for me, it's all about breaking cycles.
Yeah, right. Yeah. When you say breaking cycles, what do you mean?
Well, my father's father did the same thing. I never knew that. I had a chat to my brother who lives overseas probably about 3 or 4 months ago and he told me that my granddad did the same thing to my father and his family when my father was young. They came out from Scotland. He was here for probably a year or so and then he took off. Dad did the same thing to us, left Mum with 4 kids under the age of 13, never to be seen again. So for me, it's about breaking cycles. I want to make sure Max knows that his dad is always going to be there, you know, forever.
When you say it was daunting, what were the scary parts in those early days?
So Mum and I were together doing what we were doing for the first 3 months, and then she went to work after 3 months, and all of a sudden there's 5 days, you know, 10 hours, 50 hours on my own with Max. It's like, rightio, you know, how's this going to work? And for me, the first week or two, it was finding my feet, maybe 3 or 4 weeks. And then after that, you just sort of got into a rhythm, got into a routine and, yeah, the rest is history.
Mm. Right. David, you've got an amazing story. You were one of 5 kids, all from different dads. But for you personally, how involved was your biological father in your upbringing?
Zero. So left at age 2. So I have no recollection of my father. And it wasn't until March last year when I met him for the first time, which was at my nan's funeral, his mother's funeral. He didn't speak to me, didn't introduce himself. So there's no connection at all.
Mm. So take me back to your childhood. What were those early days like?
It was a lot about survival, I think. It was a single mother environment, a lot of different partners. There was only my younger sister and I that managed to stay with our biological mother. The other children were all adopted or fostered out. And I would care a lot for my younger sister, and Mum was missing for sometimes days on end. So it was really just about survival.
In those early days, did you feel like you had to play a bit of that father role to your sister, Kathy?
Oh, certainly, yeah, yeah. And I adored my sister up until the day she died, yeah.
So as a child, you had a hobby, I understand, and that hobby resulted in your mum having to make a pretty big decision for you and Kathy. Can you tell me what happened?
I was living in Broadmeadows in Melbourne, and Katie, my biological mother, was with a partner that wasn't good for her, and it was quite a violent relationship, and police were around often. And I had been shoplifting little model cars and planes from shopping centres, and catching the train into Melbourne as a six-year-old boy to do this, 6 and 7 years of age. So I got caught, and the police, you know, took me back to the house to drop me off and inform my mother. And of course they asked me, had I done this ever before, and I said no. He followed me into the bedroom where I tried to quickly hide all the other models that I had pinched over the years, and he knew that it was a bigger issue, and there was a great level of supervision going on. So it was soon after that we were both removed from care, or as my wardship file states, declared disowned and abandoned. We were placed into a Lambie, which was a home for about 300 children in Melbourne.
Wow. At a certain point, you ended up in a foster situation. Take me back to that time in that foster home. Where were you? What was it like?
When I settled on the farm, because this was a farming family in Albury, it was the first time I remember having stability and some certainty. So I had regular schooling, I had social sports and a network, I had endless jobs to be done, and I had endless freedom. And I was raised fairly independent, I think, from my upbringing, and that still suited me on the farm, to have that independence and to be able to explore. So it was an excellent grounding for me. I'm so blessed and privileged to have had that from age 9 through to 16.
Were there any men you could look up to as a father figure?
Foster father on the farm, Bruce. Bruce and Jean had 6 children of their own, biological children, and sadly 2 died at a young age, but Jeanette and Bruce fostered 3 more children, me being the last of them. And Bruce wasn't overly close to his own children, in my view, which had all grown up by that stage. He was a farmer and old school, not much affection, not a particular mentor either.
Were you aware that something was missing in terms of a role model, or were you not aware of it at that point?
I was not aware of the lack of a father figure, how it fails to support you into adulthood. I wasn't aware of that. I'm acutely aware of it now, but I didn't know how it would affect me back then.
Mm. Jay, what was your dad like?
My dad was that typical Polynesian father who was worked 47 hours a day, 72 days a week, and would come home and
great with maths too.
Yeah, that's right. Come home and expect dinner on the table. He was a sort of, you know, a straight-laced, a church-going man. I grew up with 5 brothers and sisters in South Auckland. But he was an orator, you know, but spoke broken English, and we used to make fun of that until, you know, you grow up and you realise that he was held in high esteem. And I suppose I took over the mantle in the secular world, in the English-speaking world, of being the orator as such. And so there are a lot of traits that he has that I have as well.
Mm. You also have 8 children of your own, don't you?
Yes, but I got my figure back, so I'm really...
So what's the age range for your kids?
My eldest is 37, my youngest is 10 now, 4 boys, 4 girls.
Right, so how many of them are at home with you at the moment?
I have 6, that's not by choice. It's just basically, if you can only move so many times and they still find you, so...
I feel compelled to ask, at what point does parenting just become crowd control for you?
Well, you know, if you don't have a dog to keep them in check, you know, it's one of those things. Look, for me, I always wanted to have a large family, but my wife is English, so, and it's always her call. And so I thought I'd have, you know, 2.5, you know, two, you know, a boy and a girl and maybe a head. You know, I just said, are you finished? And she would say, not yet. And so it was always her call, and I ended up with, you know, 8 beautiful kids.
Right. So how different would you say your parenting style is to what your dad did?
Oh, it's very different. My parenting style depends very much on what my wife says. You know, there's the
correct answer.
That you,
very good. Yeah,
there's the old saying that you can't parent your child according to how you grew up because those times are gone, and it's very true. You know, I'm very much that old school of get up, do this, do that. But my, you know, my wife is very much a negotiator.
I want to bring in Bilal and Sarah here who are joining us. Bilal, you were 20 when you became a dad. How long had you and Sarah been together at that point?
We'd been together about 6 months before we found out we were about to have our firstborn.
And what was going on in your life at that point, the two of you?
It was crazy.
Very chaotic.
Yeah, we were on drugs. We were partying a lot. We were very unstable, you could say. Didn't have any job, sort of. We were just living day to day, trying to figure out what we were going to get our next meal from.
Didn't have our life figured out at all.
So, Bilal, when you first found out you were going to be a dad, did you want to be one?
Well, I was just 20 years old. I don't know any 20-year-old is in their right head would want to be a father at that stage, you know. I didn't have anything in place, you know. As I said, I wasn't working. I didn't have stable housing. It was very rough.
You weren't prepared at all.
How far along were you, Sarah, when you found out you were pregnant?
I was actually quite far along.
And when your son Eli was born, what was Bilal's involvement in that first year, Sarah?
It was very little. He kind of went back to what he knew. He stayed in Broadmeadows. I moved up to Geelong with my parents, and my parents helped me raise Eli for the first year.
We've actually got a little clip of Eli from around about that point. Let's play now. So, Bilal, when did you decide that you wanted to be a part of Eli's life more?
It wasn't probably up until I started seeing a lot more photos of him on social media and, you know, the memories that I was missing out, you know, like his laughter, his growing, every little things that he was going through, I wasn't there, and it made me feel pretty crap about myself. You know, a father should be there for these moments, and unfortunately, I missed the first years of that. And that's when it sort of all clicked to me. You know, I need to be there, and I need to be present in his life, and you know, make sure I'm there.
How does that conversation go when you talk to Sarah? You're like, I want back in.
Surprisingly went pretty well, you know, she was all for it, although she did want me to, you know, get off drugs and you know, find a job and be a good father, and so I did, you know, it took time, but I eventually did it, and yeah, I haven't been any happier than I am now.
Bilal, what was your relationship with your dad like?
It was brief, you know. I probably spent the first 10 years of my life with him, but he was in and out of jail, so really didn't have much of a connection. Then I came over to Australia when I was about 10, so, and he's still back overseas. I haven't had any sort of connection with him for the past 15 years, you know, besides every once in a while a telephone call. There wasn't much of a relationship, you could say. It was hard.
Mm. So when you decide to step back into Eli's life, how long did it take you to, like, work out, like, the practicalities of how to be a dad?
Look, I'm still working it out, you know. yeah, it takes a long time to know what you're doing, and being a young dad too, it's very difficult. And not having a present father figure in my life, you know, to be able to relate to or to take ideas on off or ask questions, it's a lot hard, you know, so...
Mm. Sarah, what was it like watching him kind of take these ginger steps into becoming a dad?
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. I knew that he would get there. That's why I was welcoming of him coming back.
David, you now have two boys. But can you take me back to when your first son was born? Because there was a bit of a journey there too, wasn't there?
Yeah. It was a tough start to parenthood for my wife and I. We were diagnosed early in the pregnancy that there was a heart condition in the child, and that the condition was severe enough that the child would need to be born at Westmead, and we were living in Wollongong at the time. Over time, we adjusted to it and tried to research and understand. And when Nicholas was born, it was a controlled birth, really, with a number of surgeons standing by to take Nicholas and to start the surgeries that would need to save his life, which ultimately were extremely successful. And it's an excellent outcome, but it was a tough start to parenting.
Mm. How did you bond with him when he was in ICU?
I remember I was very optimistic that the outcome would be good despite the risks that were being conveyed to us by the doctors and the counsellors. And there was a period when he'd finished the third round of surgery. I was just hovering over his bed, and he was pinned down because a lot of tubes, and I was just singing, just hymning, really, very close to him. And I know he was on a lot of different drugs for the pain and the conditions, but he just opened his eye the smallest amount, and I knew that he knew that I was there with him and that I was there on that journey with him. So it wasn't a big thing, but it was a big thing for me right there at that moment.
Mm. Harold, your kids came via surrogate from India. Can you take me back to that moment, the first moment you held them?
They were in ICU as well, in Delhi, and they were tiny. They were only 1.9 kilograms each. And so I walked in, and Henry was right in front of me. And it's funny, that first meeting is a lot like their personalities now. So with Henry, I went over. He didn't wake up. he sleeps a lot still. And I could see Frankie over the other side of the ICU. I went over, said his name. He woke up. He looked, I'll never forget the look on his face, like you said, when you bonded with your child. He looked around and go, "Where have you brought me? What is this?" He had such... And I nicknamed him Cranky Frankie right then. And behind his back, that's still his...
You know this is on television, right? He's going to see this at some point.
It's past their bedtime, so they'll be fine.
So tell me the story of how you ended up pursuing surrogacy in the first place.
Well, I feel like life's kind of come full circle. Here I am on the Insight set. I was watching Insight after years of thinking about how am I going to have kids, you know, I've got to work at this, etc. Dr. Shivani was on that particular night on Insight talking about the joys of surrogacy. And then I called her the next day and talked to her directly. And she, just the integrity and everything, the way the conversation went, I was there within a couple of weeks.
Right. And so when you were finally holding these boys, do you think you were ready for it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I've never met a dad that actually thought they were ready for it, by the way. You are literally the first.
Yeah. I don't know about that now. But I was definitely... I mean, I was 49. Don't get me wrong. There are lots of moments where I'm like, oh, how do I handle this? You know, every single day, there are moments in the day where I don't feel ready. But you have to pick yourself up, pick them up, and get on with it.
Andy, yes. You're the other half of this equation.
Yeah.
Literally, on your second date, you were changing nappies, is that right?
Yeah, that's right. We had kept running into each other, and then, yeah, by the second date, I was changing nappies.
A couple beers, a couple nappies. We're on.
Yeah.
Was it daunting? Because you're not just dating a new man, you're literally dating a family.
Yeah. Yeah, it was, actually. I had to kind of be like, what's going on? This feels nice. This feels good. And just, yeah, self-assessing the situation, yeah, the whole time.
So how long did it take for you to go from the boyfriend to co-parent? Like, how does that sort of journey go?
It was about 4 months, wasn't it? Or...
it's a funny one.
Yeah.
Yeah, because...
We're hanging out...
Well, you wouldn't be a couple if you agree on the timeline, now, would you?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, that's, I mean, I would say we had a big breakthrough about 2 years ago. Like, this is lasting.
Yeah, yeah. It was about 4 months that we were living together, and it was a situation of... You're still dad number one. I'm just here taking direction from you. And then that 2 year.
And that gradually just turned into something else. And then we made a conscious decision a couple of years ago. Let's
reassess what this is and verbalise what this is now and acknowledge that we're both their fathers and, we're both.
Is it like what you expected it was going to be?
No. I never expected to be a father at all. For me, I'd never contemplated the idea as a gay man of becoming a dad.
It's those play groups, it's those mothers' groups. That's the secret group that people don't understand. You know, it's genius hacks all over the place.
Cameron, can you just take me to that moment when your wife is about to go back to full-time work? Mm. What are the sorts of things you were doing that would help build that confidence?
First thing I did was I contacted the local mothers' group and I just said, look, I'm a big, ugly, bearded guy. I know it says it's a mother's group. Can I join? And they were like, absolutely. And I was like, okay. And through that group, you know, it would start to go to, like, the sing-alongs at the library. And you would be able to observe other mothers and what they were doing with their children. And you could use those cues and see what they were doing. It gave you a little bit of confidence that you were doing the right thing.
How did your male friends react?
Well, the male friends that you've got that have kids, they think it's great. The younger male friends you have, like maybe the skateboarders down the skate park that don't have kids, immediately assume it's going to be Netflix and beers. Mm. Stay at home, dad, happy days, you know, it's put your feet up. And you know, it's definitely not like that.
Yeah.
Can I just say, just picking up, says those mothers' groups. That's the secret group that people don't understand. When I came to Australia to work on a show in 95, we had no families here, but my wife went to a play group where a mother invited her to come and join them. 25 years later, I'm emceeing the child's wedding. And I think that a lot of us don't realise that in joining a play group or joining a mother's group or whatever, especially men, is going to be your saviour, because there are a lot of mothers and a lot of grandmothers in there who'll give you recipes, who'll give you shortcuts, who'll say, don't do that, you know, put this on there and then that rash will go. And it's just one of those MacGyver places where you go in and just go, can you help me? Because, you have to strap it this way because the car seat doesn't go in that way. And all of a sudden, you know, it's genius hacks all over the place.
Was that true of you two? Were there groups that you could turn to when the boys were born?
Yeah. We did mothers' groups.
Yeah.
We were the only guys there.
And meeting up at the park and things. You also get to find out the truth about parenting, that it's not this Hallmark card, that it's stressful at times, and that you do have moments where maybe you've locked yourself in the bathroom just so you could take a few deep breaths to then go back out there. And you realise that it's not this thing of like you being an angry dad. That's a human thing that can happen.
Yeah.
That you can get frustrated as a parent.
Harold and Annie, what was your relationship with your dads like growing up?
I didn't have one, really. My dad worked in a factory in Detroit sometimes. He didn't make it to the factory sometimes. He was an alcoholic and I didn't like him very much, so...
Right.
Yeah.
Andy?
It was very up and down. My dad was bipolar. And he also struggled with drug use in his younger years and throughout his adult life as well. He never held down a job. He would come and go through for long periods of time. And, it was abusive to my mother. So there were good times, but those good times are overshadowed by the bad times.
So one theme I'm picking up from a bunch of you is this idea of really consciously breaking a cycle.
I always had a need to right the wrong. Mm. It's always been a gut need since I was like 12. Mm.
Does that idea ring true for you, David? This idea of righting a wrong, is that how you saw it?
Similar. I just felt compelled to do it better than I'd had it, that's all.
Mm.
And, when you learn about being responsible for your actions and then you understand how your actions affect others and in your family in particular, it was not very difficult for me to say, I can do this a lot better and I will try to be better.
Cameron, does that...
Yeah, I definitely touches on that. I guess, as a father growing up, they teach you those things. They teach you how to shave. I've
got to... Clearly you haven't learned that at all.
Well, yeah.
God.
I'm still learning. it's quite funny because...
You should see his legs.
For me, I've got a very vivid memory of having, when I was about 18, and not knowing how to shave, and my mate's brother showed me how to shave, and I think that was a real realisation to me that I didn't have that person to show me how to, to hammer a nail, how to change a tyre on a bike. And now that I've got Max and I want to be there for him, I don't think that any child should ever have to go through that.
Mm. Bilal, you're in your own way. You're also really breaking a cycle. Is that how you view it, though?
Definitely. I'm definitely breaking a cycle. I definitely want to give my kids a better future and have a father figure in their life and be able to teach them and everything that I wasn't taught as a kid.
Mm. I'd like to ask you all about work, because there is this traditional idea of this dad as a breadwinner. Now, Cameron, you told your work that you wanted to take a year off. Mm-hmm. How did that go?
Yeah, not good.
Not good?
No.
What happened?
What I tried to do is I tried to be the responsible one and give them as much notice as possible. I think I gave them 6, maybe 7 months notice that I was going to take 12 months paternity leave. Within about 2 to 3 weeks after that, I was called into a meeting to be told I was going to be either demoted or go under performance management.
Yeah, right.
That was a really tough time because I knew I was performing at my job and I knew that I was doing very well at what I was doing. It descended into, obviously HR issues and some formal complaints and things like that. In the end, it worked out that in my favour because, I was wronged. But it obviously left a bit of taste in my mouth.
Did their reaction surprise you?
It actually really did, yeah. And now, obviously, being a part of all the mothers' groups and meeting a lot of mothers and telling them my story, it's prolific. It's not just, me, and it's not just dads, it's mums, it's lawyers, accountants, engineers. It's a lot of these big organisations that love to preach a work-life balance, but when it comes, to push comes to shove, it's a lot of lip service.
Mm. Were you ever nervous at that idea of relinquishing that sort of long-held societal role of breadwinner?
No, not at all. No, because I'd never seen a dad that was the breadwinner. Mm. My mum was the one that gave up everything for us so we could, we could have shoes on our feet and school books and things like that. So I'd never seen the man as the primary breadwinner or the role model or the bringing the money in or anything like that.
Jay, how important is it to you as a dad to also be a provider. Do you think those two things should be linked?
Look, it is very important, but, you know, you have to understand that the word providing can be, you know, moral support, emotional support, physical support. It's always this thing, you know, a friend of mine said, you know, never take advice from a special effects guy named Stumpy, you know, and it's the same thing with my friend, you know, with my children. I go, who told you to do that? You know, well, John did, you know, John, the one that's always on detention, you know. So you're constantly just trying to balance stuff. But at the end of the day, I have to allow them to make those mistakes. And as hard as it is for a parent, you have to allow them to go to the edge there. And then you can't say, I told you so. As much as I want to, you can't, because my job, my sole job here is to leave this world knowing that my children can survive without me.
Mm. David, how important is it to your identity as a dad to also be a provider, do you think?
For me, it's quite strong. Maybe a bit traditional, but provider, defender, protector, and, you know, a job to raise independent children. So I find they're very connected. And it might be being competitive, maybe. You know, I've built a career and it's worked out well, but I do find there's a strong link for me in providing and being a carer.
And how about for you, Bilal? How are you making the balance work between providing and being a parent?
Look, it's definitely hard. You know, I work afternoon shifts, and so I really get time with my kids. The only time I get is in the morning, so it means getting up super early and having breakfast with them, taking them to daycare or kinder or whatever it may be. We do a lot of morning walks and bike rides, so trying to balance as much as I can, but at the same time, I know, because I'm the sole owner of the family, so I know I've got to provide and make sure that they have some sort of a lifestyle, you know, and not have to go hungry or have everything they want, you know.
Hmm. Richard, you research fatherhood, and statistically speaking, we know that a lot of dads, they go back to full-time work pretty quickly after having kids. What do you see the impact of that is on how they balance being a parent and providing?
Well, it puts them behind the eight ball, really. If you're trying to make a connection with your baby and you're going back to work after 2 weeks, which is the average, then you've only got that time before and after work to make that connection. And it also means that when you are with your baby, you're often not sure what you're doing because you're not there all day. So you're then asking, well, am I doing this right? And that doesn't help make that balance between the mother and the father. So I think it's an awkward situation that our cohort of dads are in now.
Mm. And are there long-term impacts on the kids that come out of that you see?
We used to think it only mattered with the mum, that as long as the dad, you know, made the money, didn't drink too much, everything would be all right. But we now know that that connection in the very early bit with the baby, that bonding that happens, that affects the baby's development in every way. And now the best for your baby is for both the mum and the dad to have that bond.
Mm. Obviously, different employers have different deals, but from a government standpoint, like, what does the government make available for dads when a child is born, Richard?
Well, now it's 2 weeks paid leave at the minimum wage. So that's what's available compared to 18 weeks for mums.
So but can I just say, you can reverse that, though. We reversed that. So I actually got what the mothers would get and my wife had the 2 weeks.
I'm interested in this idea of where people turn to when they need help. Jay, has there ever been a time where you really faced a very serious parenting challenge and you had to turn to somebody for advice?
Yes. My son at the time was suffering from depression and I was old school. And so it was very much that thing of just get up and get on, you know, stop. He just needs to get up. But my wife said, look, it's a disease, you know, and I refuse to believe that because, you know, we're invincible. We have to be like that. And it was a period in my life, especially where you were just failing and you thought, if I shout louder, I won't fail. But you realise that you could see this kid was wanting something, but you couldn't give it to him. So, you know, we went outside and sought doctors, and I had to step back because I was the alpha male and he was the alpha male, and we were just butting heads. And so in the end, it was very much that thing of, I mean, we coined a phrase, measuring successes in inches, and people would ask me, what does that mean? And go, I listen at his door and I can hear him breathing. You know, he gets up in the morning, he says hello, he had a shower, you know. And so for me, it was disappointing as a man and as a father, because I just couldn't reach this boy. But you realise really quickly that I needed somebody else. I needed professionals to say, no, this is what it is. And I, just like I listened to my directors, I had to just on face value go, okay, you know what you're doing. And the results just started happening slowly but surely through the love of his mum and my support and these teachings from other people. He started to find his way back to the world. But I was really disappointed that in myself, because as much as you can be jovial, as much as you can be this entity in the world, this so-called celebrity, I couldn't save my son.
Bilal, where do you turn to when you need advice?
We did go to a few parenting groups. A lot of the advice really came from those parenting groups and also Sarah's parents. They've been great help, really.
How do you think you would have coped if you hadn't had Sarah's parents around to kind of give that guidance?
Pretty shitty, you know. We would have struggled, definitely, you know. We're very grateful that Sarah's parents have given us a lot of support in, you know, being good parents.
Harold and Andy, a lot of the conversation today has been about sort of wrestling with traditional roles of dads. In some ways, you guys have been able to kind of build your own set of rules, but that also comes with a question of where do you turn to when you don't know what to do? So where do you turn to when you need advice?
Each other a lot.
Each other. Books. Yeah,
we had Aaron Williamson.
Yeah. I remember in the first few years, especially when I was new on the scene, I was looking at the Raising Children Australia website a lot.
Yeah, and also, it's funny, I never have thought of other fathers to go to for advice. Mm. I always think of mothers to go to for advice for some reason. I just think they have this knowledge that have this knowledge that's passed on from generation to generation that a lot of men just really don't have. And so I often go to female friends who are mothers.
Harold and Andy, have you ever actually felt like you've failed?
At the end of the day, it's...
Like every day?
Yeah. No.
Wow, that's worse than I was expecting.
It's funny, at the end of the day, I'd say 60% of the time, I don't know how you feel, but I always feel like I could have done that a little bit better. I'm a big believer in if I've made a mistake and I don't realise it to the end of the day, the next morning I bring up how I could have done something better with them.
Jay, have you ever felt like you failed?
When my children were younger, now I get told when I get failed.
I was looking at an email and the first thing he said to me is, get off your phone and watch me on the trampoline.
Yes. I get that.
Does everybody get off your phone a lot?
Yeah.
So, Doug, you're here with your granddaughter, Dakota.
Yeah.
So how is it that you became kind of the primary father figure in Dakota's life in the early days?
Well, Dakota's mum didn't really have much to do with Dakota's dad. So we just sat and discussed and said, do you really want him to know? And she went, no, well, I'm not in love with him. And I don't think it's going to work. It was sort of that situation. Mm. And I went, yeah, OK then. You're living here until you want to move out, until you're ready to move out. And you're fine.
I have it on good authority that you cut the umbilical cord too. Is that true?
Oh, yeah. Man. Dakota's dad wasn't around and we just looked at this. Well, and the doctor says, oh, you want to come in? Well, we're in there the whole time. My other daughter didn't want to see anything like that. She was 12. I don't know anything about that yet. I don't want to see that. But I was in the operating room when Jessica was born. So I cut the cord as well. And, just the first breath, I go, I got another baby. That's all I could feel. I got another baby. I got someone else here now.
Yeah. As I understand, your grandparents were quite involved in your childhood too.
Oh, yeah, yeah, a fair bit. Because my dad was away on the trawlers. He'd go, you wouldn't see him for a week or so, then he'd come back and then he'd be gone again.
Mm.
And he was a diesel mechanic, so he was always down in the thing. But he was a very good fisherman as well. So I grew up in Maruya, Baden's Bay. We had fishing rods and we had an oyster lease. We lived on lobsters and crabs and all those sort of things. And that's what I try to do with my kids. If I can get them to the beach, that's where I'd go.
You live pretty much down the road from Dakota and Amman.
We didn't move far.
No.
Couldn't handle it if they did.
Was it ever daunting to take that challenge of being that primary father figure at this age? No?
I was changing nappies when I was seven. I've got four sisters, three brothers, I'm the fourth brother. And when we moved to my nan and pops, my auntie was living there with her five kids. So there was 13 of us, so around that. My dad was away, but my mum had passed away when I was 10, so that's why we moved in with Nan.
Mm. Dakota, how important has it been for you to have such a close granddad?
Really good. Like, he's like one of the people that you want to stay close with. Like, he's just there all the time. Like, he makes me laugh. We watch movies, build a fire, have some marshmallows. And
dance to Bruno Mars and
yeah, listen to music. While
I
we
demand
just
to see that.
Yeah, music's on the foot scale.
Yeah, we listen to music all the time, dance to it.
Doug, does it keep you young?
Oh yeah. I'm 66, 67 next birthday, and I do feel like I'm 50.
David, you've been on multiple fathering adventure programs for dads and kids. I'm curious, what is it that you get out of them?
Well, it strengthens a bond with your children, and my lovely wife would probably argue that the bond is already good. But I think you can never stop really investing in the strength of the bond with your children, including all the rituals that you create, which are just beautiful. And then, you know, affirming your love for your child in front of other men carries a certain amount of weight for and meaning for the child. And so it was a very, very compelling and very powerful period of time together.
One of the interesting things they do on the Fathering Adventures is your boys get to give you feedback, which we actually have.
My feedback or advice to my dad is to take more time off work and spend more time with his family on weekends. When my dad asks me for feedback or advice, it makes me feel like I'm the father. I'm telling my son that what he's doing is different or wrong.
When dad asks me for feedback and advice, it makes me feel really empowered that, yeah, he's actually coming to me for advice.
After feedback like that, you definitely get a pay rise. So what have you taken on board? Are there things you've changed based on what your kids say?
I think being more present, so because I run my own business and I'm connected to it a lot, and so being in a room with your children but not really being present was pointed out to me, and I needed to hear that in order to know. So that's, I've become quite conscious about that now.
Who else gets feedback from their kids? Yeah. And how much of it is constructive? Cameron?
Nothing like that yet, but yeah, definitely when you touch on that side about being present, I think it is very easy to, you know, my boy, he said to me the other day, he was on the trampoline and I was looking at an email, and the first thing he said to me is, get off your phone and watch me on the trampoline. Yes.
Does everybody get off your phone a lot?
Yeah.
Doug, how much have you seen dads change, like the role that they play in their kids' life? How much have you seen that change over the years?
I've seen it heaps. A lot of dads are always there now. You see them at netball, and they seem to be doing a lot more in the day. But yeah, a lot of dads are putting more effort in to be with their kids. That's how I see it.
Richard, dads of this generation, are they different to earlier generations in your view?
Yeah, I think they are.
in, as Doug says, they're more involved, like physically doing things, and like the fellows here have said. But I think they're also, what you notice in the antenatal classes is dads say, you say, why are you here? Like, because your dad didn't go to one of these, there weren't any. And one of the threads in their answer is that, well, I want the connection with my kids.
Mm. Dakota, you've now got a stepdad. Has that changed your relationship with granddad over here?
Not really. Like, they're both there, like, all the time. Like, I get to hang out with Pop and Ryan, like, pretty much every day. And it doesn't really change.
Harold and Andy, for you guys, becoming dads was a real, like, it was a defined choice. And I'm wondering, in the years that you've become dads, what have you learnt about yourselves?
That I'm impatient and that I've learned patience. Mm. That I was always a step ahead of where I really needed to be. And I was always thinking of the next thing, what's happening next. So I think becoming a dad has really leveled it a bit for me. I'm more present.
Andy?
For me, I think it's how capable I am. Like I said about my dad, he wasn't the best role model for me. And growing up, I always was fearful of turning into him. And having kids has shown me that not only am I not like him and I'm not going to turn into him. And it's shown me that I'm a lot more capable of stuff than I originally thought.
Jay, what have you learnt about yourself as you've become a father?
That I love being a father.
Yeah.
That I couldn't imagine myself being growing up without children. I'm lucky that I have a partner that wanted to have a large family, because I wanted to have a large family, not only because I grew up with it and it's great to have a house that's just full of bodies and full of movement and full of strangers in your refrigerator. they just eat like it's a competition, goodness sake. But I think what I've learned is that when people come and tell me that you're a fantastic singer or performer or you're great at what you do, that's on you. But when people say that you've got great manners, that's on your mother and I. And I know I'm getting older because I'm happy to pay that. You know, for some reasons, like I won the lotto, I go, well, thank you very much. And they teach me every single day.
Bilal, what does it mean to be a good dad to you? What does that look like?
You know, I'm still learning to be a good dad. It's not easy to be a good dad. You've got to put a lot of effort.
Taking time,
you know, listening to them, showing them what's right and what's wrong. Just instilling guidance in them, you know, making sure they don't turn out like anything like I was or anything like, you know, my dad was or is.
Mm. I understand that Sarah's dad was a pretty big role model for you and he passed away recently. How has that affected you, not having that role model around anymore?
Look, it affected me a lot, especially because my oldest was very close to him and the time that I wasn't there in his life, Pa was in his life, you know, and he pretty much loved him like as if it's his own. You know, it still kind of affects me because, you know, my son sort of looks up to him more than he looked up to me. You know, so I'm trying to fill that shoes that Pa did, you know. It's definitely hard.
Sarah, what has it been like watching Bilal come into his own as a dad, not just of one kid, but of two kids now?
Yeah, he's really blossomed. It's been so amazing from what he started as to what he is now, and he's still growing, and he loves learning. He's really open to learning. He's open to changing. He's just been fantastic, and he's on a really good path, and he's doing really well.
Mm. Cameron, have you and your wife ever talked about swapping the roles?
No, not at the not really, no, because my wife is very career-driven and, you know, I've got no qualms with that. She's way more career-driven than I am. I'm happy to, you know, when I left my job, to just do what I need to do to help out around the house. I do a bit of photography. I drive Uber a day or two a week before all the COVID was happening. We're trying to start another business. Anything I can to sort of help out and just contribute a little bit, I will do.
So Max is four, which mm-hmm. means he's going to be entering school pretty soon.
Yep.
Do you ever have any anxieties about potentially re-entering the workforce full-time again?
Yeah, I do. You know, I had Max when I was 42, so I'm 47 this year. We all know that there's issues with people entering the workforce, I guess, later on in life. I think that the way we're going to address it is hopefully the business that we've started, we will be independent and sole trader, and then I won't have to have that sort of anxiety of trying to enter the workforce again.
Mm. For you, David, what's the most important thing you want to pass on to your kids?
I think that they grow to be resilient and strong and independent and, you know, live the life that they're destined to live and to do that in the right way with respect to the people around them and that they carry good values. I hope that that's how life turns out for them.
Jay, what's the most important thing you want to pass on to your kids?
To respect their elders. Please and thank you will always get fed. But I think for me, the most important thing is to chase the joy. Chase the joy in your life. Sometimes, you know, you won't get paid for it, but if you chase the joy, you'll always find a place where you belong.
Well, to all of you, thank you so much for joining us. That is all we have on Insight tonight.